Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Settling the Boom, the Sites and Subjects of Bakken Oil, edited by Mary E. Thomas and Bruce Brown, narrated by Suzie Althens. Preface. Settling the Boom, the Sites and Subjects of Bakken Oil, is a collection of essays that examine efforts to contain the lively and disruptive petrocultures of an oil boom and its aftermath in a remote northwestern corner of North Dakota, and to expose their underlying settler colonial frameworks. Rather than simply charting a course through the boom-bust extraction cycle, our book analyzes what Mark Rifkin calls the privileged background epistemologies that establish a condition of possibility in settler colonialism's violent and ongoing extension in time and space. Our goal in assembling this edited book is to illustrate the work that goes into settlerist orderings of time and place as a practice of critique and disruption of the all-too-familiar logics and practices of settler colonialism and racialized heteropatriarchy in the oil fields of North Dakota. We ask, how does a frenetic boomtown and its region come to be ordered through familiar settler affective infrastructures, aesthetics, and narratives? How do the forces of the settler state, petrocapital, and heteropaternal urban messaging and planning in the Bakken work to congeal the boom within certain social and spatial forms and not others? How do these orderings fold and refold time and space in their attempts to ensure that futures remain imagined through and tethered to settler colonialism and white patriarchies? We, and the other contributors to the book, answer these questions through analysis of the powerful settler colonial, cisgendered, heterosexual sentimentalities operating to calm the region's anxieties after what had been assumed to be a certain future built on fossil fuel extraction. Many of the themes across the chapters in Settling the Boom found their first iteration in a workshop hosted by us, Matt Coleman and Catherine Yusoff, in the summer of 2015. The Antipode Foundation sponsored this field-based gathering of 14 scholars through an international workshop award, and a reporting of the workshop's culminating conversation titled Grounding the Anthropocene, Sites, Subjects, Struggles in the Bakken Oil Fields can be found on Antipode Online. Five of the contributors to this book, the two of us and Morgan Adamson, Thomas S. Davis, and Jessica Lehman, attended the workshop, and the author Kai Bosworth had a mention in the Antipode posting from Bruce. In the report of the Grounding of the Anthropocene workshop, several participants noted the ways that boomtown narratives inhabit a cruel optimism in which the promise of a better future seems forever out of reach, an expanding horizon of hopeful possibility, fueling a horrific present of dangerous work, exhaustion, transient lives, longing for the promise of the good life. And as participant Mario Blazer notes, treacherous land relations that overshadow other beliefs. He asks, what kinds of infrastructures, material semiotic assemblages of attachment and detachment to this place and others, are there? What kinds of attachments and detachments do they foster? These questions and the enduring prompt from Lauren Berlant's Cruel Optimism remain at the heart of this volume. Indeed, Mario's questions are as relevant today as in 2015. Finalizing this project now, in 2022, offers a different perspective from that of 2015. Today we situate our arguments, not just around the boom's temporal unfolding and from the moment just after the commodity price fell in the autumn of 2014, but more important, we also attend to the boom's social, spatial reconciliations. While booms disrupt, displace, and replace, the socio-ecological forms that congeal in their wake require considerable aesthetic, narrative, and political work. Indeed, the very fabrication of the Bakken boom stories told and retold ensure in their familiar repetition an all-too-easy alignment of what happened and what is yet to come. Yet that rote telling and representation of settlement, we argue in the introduction, is not sturdy, inevitable, or final, or even for that matter, accurate. Settling is processual, complex, provisional, contingent. The predominant versions of how calm returned to Western North Dakota indicate the normative forces fueling those versions more than they reflect a reality of what happened. The very notions of settlement, of catching up after the chaos of the boom, and a calm return to normal, are not objective accounts of next stages in time, as all of the essays in this book demonstrate. Further, these notions of settlement assert an oil boom as an aberration, rather than assemblages and continuations of forces that propel, encourage, and precede or exceed it. Their precise resolutions over time in specific locations are impossible to predict from within the boom or even from generalized theories of petrocultures. In fact, the moment of resolution is an open one, without end in time-space. In this book, we resist the pull to provide a timeline of our own for Bakken geographies and geologies, which would merely resubmit an authoritative settler perspective through the back door as an academic account of what happened. As this project's editors, we understand our roles as white settler scholars in more modest terms, as ones that can work to lay bare the geographic and temporal propulsion of settler colonialism's linearities, its machinations of white supremacist heteropatriarchy, and its material hierarchies and violences, including those experienced by workers drawn to the region by the promises of economic security and personal redemption. Even as we refuse settlerist spatial and temporal accounts as fully representative of what happened in the Bakken, in this book, we elevate attention on how settler colonialism's entrenched commitments to futurity operate linear time as progress, particularly through heteronormative family formation and social reproduction, frontier spaces of masculine labor and mineral extraction, understood as economic and U.S. national expansion. As white settler scholars, we take our roles to be aptly focused on bringing background epistemologies to the foreground of Bakken petrocultures and geographies in order to understand and challenge colonial infrastructures of attachment. By parsing these formations, we show their ad hoc nature, how they provisionally hold together, yet also contain the contradictions, possibilities, and elements of other stories and truths. These forces and formations are specific to the sites and subjects of the Bakken. Attending to their qualities exposes how settlement works in Williston, North Dakota, and questions what and who gets removed or erased in service to the settler temporalities fabricated. We resolutely do not take it as our role, as white settlers, to represent indigenous interests or subjects, though about one quarter of Bakken oil is produced on the lands of the three affiliated tribes of the Mandan, Hidatsa, and Arikara, MHA, nation on the Fort Berthold Reservation. Our perspective refuses what Audra Simpson labels as settlerist good intentions, which would merely add alternative accounts to the boom to provide a supposedly more inclusive picture, which merely maintains a lie that settler states and societies can diversify and not have to fundamentally decolonize and revolutionize. These divergent temporalities can be seen in the controversial slogan used by supporters of oil development in the MHA nation. The tribal chairman in 2011, Tex Hall, proclaimed sovereignty by the barrel as a direct challenge to the linear trajectory of settler time and its background assumption of the space-time of the nation-state, its institutions, and its interests. Although not uncontested within the community, oil development on MHA land from this perspective is not just about economic development achieved through royalties and production taxes, oil field jobs, and direct oil production controlled by a tribal corporation. It also points to, and potentially facilitates, an indigenous temporality that is different from settler time, shaped by the land and the relationships and responsibilities it entails. While understood variously, these relationships and responsibilities open to diverse indigenous futures, even within the slow accretion of settler violence, the breaking of treaties, flooding of tribal lands to secure downstream white communities and their agricultural economies, displacement of whole communities to new sites, water governance, residential schools, the exposure of Native people to settler policing, and Native women and children in particular to settler violence, that has produced an affective world that diverges radically from white settler subjectivities and imaginaries. We do not attempt to describe or represent the complex and heterogeneous indigenous temporalities in the region or arbitrate different positions held by MHA members in relation to fossil fuel extraction. Our goal is not to fracture settler frameworks and temporalities in order to elevate Native sites and subjects. We have not been invited to undertake these tasks. The land and its futures are not ours, or that of any settlers. We do take as our task the practice of undermining settler white supremacist beliefs, especially as they work to reassert racialized heteropatriarchies as the legible formations of life and place in the region now and into the perpetual horizon of settler time. We do insist that there is nothing inevitable about settler colonial heteropatriarchies, despite their widespread iterations in Bakken Boomtown stories and visualities. As Mark Rifkin writes, exploring what constitutes the background for marking and experiencing time then draws attention not only to the milieu, at whatever scale, that serves as the context for thinking and feeling time's unfolding, but also to the taken-for-granted process through which temporal dynamics are figured. What white settlers violently take for granted does not equate to what is or will be. We thus understand settler backgrounds as unresolved and unsettling questions, questions without answers, and that we should not resolve by merely adjudicating other, better settler renditions. Yet politics and resistance do not begin and end with making settler colonialism visible. As Eve Tuck and K. Wayne Yang warn, doing so can merely be a gesture to ensure its future. Our work in this volume, especially in the introduction, is therefore to unsettle what settler colonial forces assume is resolved, to show that the disruptive boom has not settled down into a resolved future or into, as usual, accounts of oil's political economies. There are other inheritances besides settler colonial heteropatriarchies. The research that informs our work as editors was collaborative and spanned a number of years. Bruce has been a longer interlocutor with the region, with many years of passing through Williston. His witnessing the curious changes to the region over time led to this project in the first place. We visited the region together over the course of 3 summers, 2014 to 16, with a larger team, including Matt Coleman, Max Woodworth, and Catherine Yusoff, interviewing a range of oil field workers, city officials, local historians and curators, workforce trainers and job placement advisors, journalists, land and water protectors, and even a Lutheran pastor who explained how he led a community funeral to provide closure for his Williston congregation who had lost their settler, prairie idol, to widespread drilling and disruption. These interviews and our conversations profoundly shape the ideas in this book, as does the feedback received on earlier chapter drafts. We owe the origins of this idea-making to the larger research group. Thank you. We also send gratitude to all of our interviewees, especially Donald Kress of the Williston Planning Office, for his hospitality and patient explanations about a huge range of urban and regional issues and geographies. Artist Jessica Christie provided cover art for Settling the Boom from her collection, Through the Window. We saw the collection when we visited the exhibition, Bakken Boom, Artists Respond to the North Dakota Oil Rush, in 2015, at the Plains Art Museum in Fargo. Jessica, originally from eastern North Dakota, lived in Minot, at the eastern edge of the Bakken at the beginning and at the height of the boom. Her installation in Fargo included 150 shadow boxes containing what she calls relics, or found objects, that were all assembled in a very small space. The installation visitor experienced the claustrophobia of the boom's imprint on everyday life, especially for women, through the box's contents and arrangement. The Plains Art Museum's exhibition was a steady source of inspiration as we conducted research and as we continue to teach about the boom. So we are delighted and honored to have Jessica Christie's art frame this collection. Thank you, Jess. We gratefully acknowledge our graduate advisee research assistants, especially Jessica Lehman and Mary Everest, who worked with Bruce, who also thanks the Grant in Aid of Research, Artistry, and Scholarship Program at the University of Minnesota for funding, and Krista Benson, Anthony Tenney, and Mary Byrne, who worked with Mary, who thanks the Department of Women's, Gender, and Sexual Studies at The Ohio State University for funding, our colleagues and friends, and reviewers, for their many comments and incisive feedback on drafts and presentations, and research funding from Humanities Without Walls, the University of Minnesota, and the Division of Arts and Humanities in the College of Arts and Sciences at The Ohio State University, which provided funding for Thomas S. Davis and Mary E. Thomas. Most important, we thank the chapter authors for their patience during the long pandemic years, which slowed completion, and editor Jason Wiedemann and the staff at the University of Minnesota Press for their steady and incisive stewardship. Introduction. Unsettling the Boom. Mary E. Thomas and Bruce Brown. Bakken Booyah! Rockin' the Bakken! Bakken Goes Boom! These exuberant marketing slogans greeted us when we entered the Williston Economic Development Office in the summer of 2014. Though not evident at the time, North Dakota was just about to hit the end of an oil boom after several years of rapid growth. The region's population had increased dramatically as workers poured in to fuel the seemingly insatiable demand for labor. The local housing shortage was acute, with hundreds of people sleeping in their vehicles on the city streets and in parking lots every night. Construction projects spread across the landscape, adding hotels, restaurants, single-family homes, schools, new roads, water and sewage lines, and apartment, retail, and office complexes at every turn. The price per barrel was high, the number of rigs drilling was high, wages were high, food and services prices were high, revenue was high, the mood was high. Only a few years removed from the Great Recession, national media was still fixated on the region's wild ride as it soared along with record-setting commodity prices. The executive director of the Economic Development Office showed us chart after chart that day, predicting the steady growth of oil production, jobs, and population until at least 2050. One chart he shared, made by the Western North Dakota Energy Project, predicted that Williston's regional population would hit between 100,000 and 120,000 by 2020, and slowly increase from there for at least another two decades, the ascending line at the right margin hinting at growth in perpetuity. As the director put it earlier that year in a public presentation, "It is going to last for a very long time." It is 2021 as we finalize this introduction, and the city of Williston's population hovers around 29,000, with another 8,600 in the rest of Williams County. Adding neighboring McKenzie and Divide counties contributes another 17,000 to the population for the Williston region. Williston has a speculative bond rating lower than junk, and the Economic Development Office is not high anymore. Its current slogan, somewhat pleadingly, proclaims that the city is open for business. The Williston Community Guide tries to sell the city's appeal for young, millennial families, its quality of life, ample employment opportunities, and wholesome recreational offerings. The guide invites the reader to settle in. The boomtown high has evaporated, replaced with empty hotel rooms, unfinished development projects, a new international airport that is largely unused, and crushing municipal debt. A past, produced pre-pandemic in early 2020, Economy at a Glance document for the city quotes the current director's caution. I am sorry to say these numbers will continue to get worse before they get better. Commodity reliance can be cruel to towns like Williston, but optimism girds the assurance that better comes after worse. Like the right margin of perpetual growth, the messaging remains primed for the future's possibilities. This book considers specific boomtown stories, aesthetics, and relations in northwestern North Dakota in order to contend with settlement. We and the other chapter authors place keen attention on Bakken Booyah storytelling, textual and visual, precisely to examine how it engages with and enacts the lively and potentially disruptive petrocultures of the Bakken Boom, and, with varying degrees of success, attempt to contain this storytelling within normative, affective infrastructures and understandings. Rather than evaluating the right margin through a correction of its predictive failures and a revised account of its data, we interrogate the temporality of that margin and what it insinuates about the temporal imaginings and affective attachments that run through North Dakota's oil cultures. We contend with settlement, in other words, by situating the oil play as an iterative process through its myriad attempts to order the sites and subjects of the Bakken. Central to this process are settler colonial temporalities and tenses, and the privileged settler background epistemologies that Mark Rifkin argues establish a condition of possibility in settler colonialism's violent and ongoing supremacy. As an iterative process, settling the Bakken Boom uses the power of settler colonial narratives and aesthetics to repeat beliefs about time as unfolding into a waiting future. The margin is therefore no ending of a process, but its perpetual extension, especially, as we will show throughout the book, through heteronormative patriarchies and fossil fuel extraction. The margin can merely gesture into that waiting future, however, because the accomplishment of any optimistic settled form is, as Lauren Berlant so astutely argued, fantasy. They write, "Fantasy is the means by which people hoard idealizing theories and tableaux about how they and the world add up to something." Berlant famously points to the cruel optimism of effect in the present as a relation that exists when something you desire is actually an obstacle to your flourishing. We take the right margin of perpetual growth to be an affective structure that attempts to translate the energies and flows of an oil play into an apparent, if spectral, order that will appear at some point in the future, supposedly. The waiting for boomtown settlement thus enacts a wide range of violence and land dispossession and justifies these through assurances that something better is coming, in time. Yet, settling the boom as a project is centrally motivated by our belief that we should work against the affective structures of settlerism and, importantly, also against an academic provision of post hoc, alternative political imaginaries in response to them. Each imagines a settled form, as if settlement is achieved and final, and that which we should reactively address in our scholarship, as if alternatives are not always in creative existence and tension all along, or as if alternatives are not themselves potentially more banal in their own attempts at transformation. After all, as Berlant suggests, most often nothing actually occurs that is all that different. In fact, the promise of something else, a break, like a boom or its bust, might even be the very route into further normative colonial settlement. Across this volume, the chapters pay special attention to the specificity of the Bakken as a site, as we situate the predominant, affective structures seeking to settle the boom in the region. By delving into the geographies and aesthetics of the region's settler colonial formations and examining its site-specific iterations, our analyses seek to relay the ways that foreclosures and erasures in time and place actually operate not as effects that necessarily follow from resource extraction, but as enacted and provisional relations, temporalities, and materialities specific to this place at this time. As we wrote with collaborators in 2015, without keen attention to the site, the oil boom becomes so generalized that its specific spatial, geological, and temporal aspects go unexamined. And as a narrative form, the boom-bust cycle remains intact as a future-oriented threshold pointing to what comes next. The chapters in this book, in contrast, push against a temporal fetish of the Bakken's right margin through the author's grounding analyses of the place, its geology and land, and the reiterative settler geographies of its subjects. Central to our collective task is to expose the affective structures of settler time. Following Audra Simpson, we situate settler time and its place in the Bakken region as fiction. Simpson writes that settler time is the fiction of the presumed neutrality of time itself, demonstrating the dominance of the present by some over others, and the unequal power to define what matters, who matters, what pasts are alive, and when they die. Like the ever-expanding carbon capitalism and settler colonialism that the right margin fantasizes, settler time represents events and conditions in place as they may be rendered into a waiting future always already imagined as a settler future. In the Bakken, settler time establishes land not as relation, but as that which is perpetually extractable, objectified, and passive, waiting only for the right time for commodification and improvement. We argue that tense is a vital component of settlement, especially the future anterior, or future perfect, per Elizabeth Povinelli, 2011. This verb tense indicates something that is expected to happen before a specific time in the future. It will have. The concept of development, for instance, assumes an accomplished event that will have been completed in the future. It is the promise toward which the present labors and for which the labors of the present are justified and endured. As we and other authors explain, the future anterior fuels the cruel optimisms that pervade the petrocultures of North Dakota and help sustain its normative forms. Indeed, as we explore in the book's conclusion, nowhere is the play of tense more evident than in the promises attached to infrastructure, roads, pipelines, airports, housing, as that which will finally translate the volatility of an oil boom into a settled and settler future of prosperity and uninterrupted progress. As the spectral promises of infrastructure illustrate, boomtown narratives and aesthetics often fail to fully accomplish what they seek to represent, visualize, and form. We and the other authors argue that the boom is not yet, and will never be, settled. Settlement is never accomplished per se, for indeed, the sites and subjects of the Bakken boom are always open for contention, change, and protest, despite the tidy reconciliations and renderings that suggest a final version of what happened or that project a normative vision of what is to come. This is, at heart, why we titled the volume Settling the Boom, as a reminder of the open, contested, and contentious nature of settlement. Almost a decade after oil's price collapse halted most drilling in the heart of the Williston Basin, in late 2021, there are fewer than 24 rigs in the six-county region. That settling continues, as does the need to unsettle the forceful narratives and visualities that propose to represent and respond to what happened. Settler aesthetics and settler time. What allowed for predominant agreements about what happened in the Bakken to settle? Or to ask this slightly differently through Elizabeth Povinelli's provocation. What happens when we ask the question of how can various modes of existence establish or maintain their normative force in a world? These agreements foreclose and contain normative settling of Williston and the region, including heteropatriarchy, settler colonial military and police forces, the desire for capital growth, petrocultures, and more, all of which align to make alternatives, and otherwise, as Povinelli puts it, invisible in predominant narrated formations. More insidious than an aligned and overt conspiracy to reestablish settler family life in present-day North Dakotan America, boomtown narratives and aesthetics, mapped onto and reestablished these normative infrastructures iteratively as they extended their trajectory into the ever-expanding future. As the chapters in the book illustrate, close analyses of Bakken social aesthetic formations expose the routes through which normative foreclosure occurs, and as such, can suggest or strengthen other temporalities, subjectivities, and places to current predominant formations. Of course, it is not our role to liberate these alternatives from subjugation, nor is liberation possible, as Povinelli cautions. She notes that such adjudications merely bind us more tightly to the frameworks that govern thought. Instead, drawing on her words, we seek to understand an alternative as a way station for the emergence of something else. In white North Dakota, deep cultural and political commitments to settler colonial and heteronormative paternalism reside in heroic storytelling and familial legacies of European migration and land occupation. These stories assemble narratives and aesthetics of the good life in North Dakota around white supremacist, settlerist, capitalist, nationalist, and heteropaternal priorities, and are socio-spatial geologic in that they build structures and infrastructures around them. The settler colonial timeline seamlessly stitches U.S. frontier exploration to farming and resource extraction over multiple temporalities in the region, as Mary E. Thomas also shows in her chapter. Settler colonial stories from frontier days, for example, invariably sit side by side with contemporary energy displays in the region's museums. Museums offer sedimented and sentimental spaces of and for local and regional celebration and embed in their stories and displays familiar affective structures through which presumed audiences, white, settler, straight, and cisgender, can relate their experiences to the regions. For example, the Missouri Yellowstone Confluence Interpretive Center in the heart of the Bakken displays bottled oil as historical, geographic, and geological artifact in service to settlerist extraction. The website of the center boasts permanent exhibits explore the geography and geology of the area, its prehistoric life, and the impact of people arriving by trails, tracks, rivers, and roads, which is also the name of the exhibits area. Featured in this exhibit will be the Lewis and Clark Journey, the Fur Trade Era, Fort Buford, and the development of the modern-day irrigation and energy industries. Stories about the site and its subjects may claim to represent a history, but they repeat the settler myths of the land and earth as a frontier for its ever-expanding settler temporalities. Settler time creates its frontier places through settler land grabs, militarization, sexual and gender violence, commodification of land and matter for extraction, whiteness, and settlerist familial formations. This extractive view, Macarena Gomez-Barris writes, sees territories as commodities, rendering land as for the taking, while also devalorizing the hidden worlds that form the nexus of human and non-human multiplicity. Seeing is a perception that is learned through settler logics and values such as these. Indigeneity is erased and made past, prehistoric, in the language of the interpretive center, and the complexities of past, present, future indigenous temporalities and spatialities occluded. Frontier stories beat within the Bakken Booyah, a marketing theme used by the Williston Economic Development Office to provide the aspirational pulse of its unfolding in settler time. Settler colonial tropes of strong and able-bodied white men served as constant references in the region's politics, workforce management, urban and regional planning, extraction practices, and media coverage, as several chapters of this book show. Bakken Booyah engages the violent nationalist and masculinist infrastructures of oil and celebrates gleefully the profit in each. Booyah is a term of triumph with an affective tone of masculine domination in your face. The term is often used in competitive sports and aligns closely with U.S. military cries like the Marines' Oorah. The saturation of U.S. military infrastructures in the region's petroleum economies is no recent event, as the Army's role in settler colonization attests. Kai Bosworth's chapter in this book examines the policing tactics of oil assemblages as North Dakota's police and sheriff departments and their national allies brutally sought to repress and criminalize water protectors at Standing Rock. He astutely shows how the police drew on a long-standing trope of settler vulnerability in the face of indigenous threat to justify this militarized violence. As an aesthetic of economic development, Bakken Booyah also iterates a renewed celebratory and gloating sensibility of the Bakken's unique position as a frontier, as one of the few places in the United States at the time of the Great Recession to have jobs and sites for capital investment, both of prime interest for the Economic Development Office as it recruited new businesses to the city of Williston. Morgan Adamson interrogates in her chapter how these sentiments played into the aesthetics of the last great place for opportunity, urban messaging in Williston. As Adamson and Thomas both insist in their chapters, the resource frontier and its urban aspirations are firmly grounded in hopes that the patriarchal family formation's enduring anchoring will assure a growing city. Boomtown depictions across an array of media centered on conservative and modest white male farmers, whose weathered faces showed the years of hard work taming the prairie and tied them to the next generation of North Dakota patriarchs who were both their children as well as newcomers like roughneck oil workers with their oil and dirt-smeared faces. Chapters by Jessica Lehman and Bruce Brown and by Thomas S. Davis consider the figure of the masculine oil worker whose apparent determination to find his own fortunes and party hard while doing so was often glorified, yet a constant source of anxiety for civic leaders. The Boomtown's emphasis on turning oil workers into family men who will build a settled town shows that the constant, central reference point for effective structures of the Bakken oil boom steadily remained heteromasculine and white settlerist, encompassing nationalist and capitalist commitments, themes that find further analysis in chapters by Adamson and Thomas. Thus, at a time of financial upheaval during the Great Recession, after years of war in Iraq and Afghanistan, settler colonial icons from the American prairie and its oil frontier framed past, present, and future events, arranging existence and subjugating other possibilities along the way. Settler time also rests squarely on the artifacts of extraction technology in the region. The common story of the most recent oil play begins with two key technological innovations, horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracking, that catapulted the Bakken into prominence as a major global oil and gas producer after decades playing a very minor role. As we discuss, horizontal drilling allowed oil companies to maneuver along the strata, dramatically increasing the pay zone of the play. In turn, fracking enabled the oil previously trapped in the poorly connected pores of the petroleum system to migrate to the well. In a fashion similar to the population graphs discussed earlier, fracking technology and its potential to unlock tight oil also extends time at the right margin, as horizons for future extraction are projected ever deeper into the stratigraphy. Represented in ubiquitous diagrams of the region's stratigraphy, massive simplifications of the Earth's geological complexity, the Bakken formation presented to investors and civic leaders the fantasy of an ever-expanding horizon for capital, not limited just to a thin stratum buried almost 2 miles underground, but ever more oil trapped further below. As Bruce Braun argues in his chapter, the extension and deepening of settler and capitalist time in the Bakken was often cruel and violent to workers who migrated to the region. The combination of a stubborn geological formation, new technologies, and the demand to speed up production by highly leveraged oil companies resulted in a deadly expenditure of labor as workers displaced by the Great Recession were thrown into largely unregulated workspaces. Rather than understand workplace injuries and deaths as extraordinary, out-of-time aberrations, Braun instead reveals its continuity with the corporal violences of wage labor in advanced capitalism, even as the oil industry naturalized and effaced worker deaths through a rhetoric of oil field work as inherently dangerous, sheltering the violence of oil field work in the Bakken, and wage labor in general, from critique. Earlier, more modest efforts to extract fossil fuels in the region thus also fame Bakken Booyah, settler infrastructures, and extractive views. Indeed, the story of an extraordinary event unfolding in staid, remote northwestern North Dakota hides the fact that oil exploration is at least a century old in North Dakota. Success in drilling only came in the 1950s, however. A small plaque near Tioga in Williams County now marks the location where, in 1951, the Clarence Iverson No. 1 well was sunk and hit a profitable reserve. It produced 585,000 barrels between 1951 and 1980. At the time, the recovered oil and gas source was Madison limestone, early middle Mississippian, at a depth of around 8,400 feet. But the region's productivity in the 1950s and 1960s was limited. As these conventional wells lost productivity, and as about half of all new wells came up dry, the cost of new discovery and development efforts did not match the prospects of a profitable return. Until the early 1980s, the steady influence of oil in the northwestern corner of the state took a back seat to agriculture. Small derrick pumps sparsely spotted the prairie landscape, pumping steadfastly but slowly around the grain and lentil fields. That scenario changed when high oil prices, spurred by OPEC's price inflation in the 1970s and early 1980s, made oil exploration profitable again, and new discoveries led to increased production. Williams County and its neighbors again became flush with oil investment. In a few short years, the number of rigs operating in the Williston Basin more than quadrupled, peaking in 1980 at 119. That year, the state of North Dakota brought in $68.5 million on oil and gas leases on public land, an increase of 1,000% over 4 years. While the production peak in 1984 was modest by today's standards, 150,000 barrels per day in the state marked the height of a pronounced, though brief, oil boom. These earlier oil plays established not only regional narratives and aesthetics for the Bakken boom, but literally landscaped expectations through temporality and tense. The mapped oil appears just waiting to be freed sometime at the right margin. Ungrounding the Bakken settlement. To U.S. settlers, Nothing seems less murky and more timeless than the ground beneath their feet, understood as property, territory, and resource. Yet the firmness of this ground is itself a settler fiction. In this section, we seek to explain how the boom writes settler colonial temporalities and territorialities into the land and earth, materializing a specific settler geosocial arrangement from within the multiplicity of geological life. The idea of a geosocial formation, as imagined by Nigel Clark and Catherine Yusoff, helps us to think about how social geographic arrangements are materialized in and through the land, air, water, and earth, and its subtending strata. Geosocial formations, they write, are richly layered. They include prior manifestations and, despite their fixed appearance, wrap unactualized possibilities within them. What is known as the Bakken Formation is such a geosocial formation. It carries the name of a settler, after Henry Bakken, and is narrated within petroleum geology, a powerful but partial way of sensing, knowing, and simplifying the Earth's forces and affordances. As a relatively narrow rock layer holding billions of barrels of oil in deep, impermeable shale. The layer is mostly located 2 miles below the surface of northwestern North Dakota, extending into what settlers have territorialized as eastern Montana, southwestern Manitoba, and southeastern Saskatchewan. Stratigraphically, it lies near the bottom of the Williston Basin, a circular depression of sedimentary rock that began its subsistence almost 500 million years ago. The Bakken is not contiguous within the entire Williston Basin, but is a layer within part of its center area. As told by geologists, the Bakken Formation began at the turn of the late Devonian and early Mississippian periods, about 350 to 400 million years ago, when the region was much closer to the equator and covered with shallow seas. This warm, lively ecosystem is understood to have been the site for the slow accumulation of silt, clay, sand, limestone, and organic matter that would, after immense heat and pressure from the weight of subsequent deposition, structure the Bakken's shale layer between two limestone layers. The shale encased the rich organic matter of the day, that is, the life that eventually became fossilized as oil and natural gas, into small pockets within it. Over hundreds of millions of years, tectonic processes would carry the submerged material to the northern latitudes. The very notion of fossilized matter as resource reaches into these sedimented spatio-temporalities to build settler, nationalist, hopeful futures. An oil resource is, after all, fossilized life imagined and remade as present and future value. Moreover, settling the boom through an extractive view is a process intent on situating and fixing the dynamic movements of rock, fossil, and land as American or Canadian through its settler colonial territorialization. Today, mineral rights and liberal recognition politics refuse to situate claims to land and resources except through settler colonial law, property, and ownership. Not to mention that a settler farmer's name identifies the strata, familiarizing the geosocial formation and rendering the settler indigenous to the region.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.